what I'm hoping to explore in this video is the notion of a sample space. And it's a pretty, hopefully you'll find, straightforward idea. If you're having if you're doing a trial, something that is probabilistic, a trial or an experiment, a sample space is just all of the, it's the set of the possible outcomes. So a very simple trial might be a coin flip. So if you're talking about a coin flip, well then the sample space is going to be the set of all the possible outcomes. So you could get a heads, or you could get a tails. That right over here is the sample space for the coin flip. So, and it's very useful because, you know, for example, if these are equally likely outcomes, then and you say, well, what's the probability of the event of a heads? You say, okay, that's one out of the two equally likely outcomes. Or you can even construct, once you know all of the possible outcomes, even if they aren't equally likely, you could say, well, let's create a probability distribution. We at least know what the sample space is. We know what the possible outcomes are. Now let's think about the probability of each of those outcomes. But a lot of times when people talk about sample spaces, they tend to be most useful, I would say, when you have equally likely outcomes, like in the case of a fair coin flip. Because then from the sample space, it's fairly straightforward to think about the probability of various events. But this is a simple sample space right over here, but let's make things a little bit more interesting. Let's imagine a world, so let's just put this aside a little bit. Let's imagine a world where there's a bakery, and at that bakery, there are three flavors of cupcakes, but there's also three different sizes of cupcakes. So now we're essentially looking at two different ways in which the thing that we're going to be sampling can vary. So what we're doing, or let me write this down. So we have our flavors of cupcakes at this bakery, and let's say that you have chocolate, you have, let's say there's strawberry, and let's say that there is vanilla, and they come in three different sizes. So sizes could be small, so I'll just write it out, small, medium, or large. So if you were, and let's say, you know, each of these flavors come in each of these sizes, or you could view it the other way around, each of these sizes come in all three flavors. So now how do you construct the sample space? If you were to say, look, I'm gonna blindfold myself and walk into this bakery and randomly, you know, somehow pick up a cupcake, and you know, my fingers can't tell the flavor or the size of the cupcake, what are the possible outcomes for the cupcake I'll pick? And the outcome would be both the flavor and the size of the cupcake. Well, there's a bunch of ways to think about this. One way is you could draw a tree. You could say, okay, well, I'm gonna pick three different flavors. I could either pick chocolate, I'm gonna pick strawberry, or I'm going to pick vanilla. And then for each of those flavors, I'm gonna pick a small, medium, or large. So you could say small, medium, large. Small, and so this is a small chocolate, this is a medium chocolate, this is a large chocolate. This is a small strawberry, medium strawberry, large strawberry. This is a small vanilla, medium vanilla, large vanilla. And so you see there's nine possible outcomes. Once again, this is a medium chocolate. You picked a chocolate and it was a medium one. This is a large vanilla. You picked a vanilla and it is a large one. And you could have done it the other way around. You could have said, well, okay, I'm gonna either pick a small, medium, or large. And then for each of those, I'm gonna pick either a chocolate, strawberry, or vanilla. And I'll just use the first letters to, so I'm either gonna pick a chocolate, a strawberry, or a vanilla. When I write the S over here in this magenta color, I'm talking about the flavor. And if I write the S in green, I'm talking about small. So here, you could have, if you have a medium cupcake, it could be chocolate, it could be strawberry, or it could be vanilla. If you have a large cupcake, it could be chocolate, strawberry, or vanilla. So for example, this was a medium chocolate cupcake. Over here, a medium chocolate cupcake is this one. It's medium chocolate. It would be that one over here. So you could use these, kind of a tree diagram like this, to think about the sample space, to think about the 9 possible outcomes here. But you could also do a, I guess you could say a grid, where you could write the flavors. So you could have chocolate. Actually, let me just write the, well, let me write them out. Actually, let me just write the letters, since it's going to take a long time to do. So you could have the flavors, chocolate, strawberry, vanilla. So that's along that axis. And then you have your sizes. You could have a small, a medium, or large. And you can set up a grid here. So this is another way to do it. And notice this grid has 9 boxes. So let's look at it. So set up the grid. And so what is this one going to be? This is a small chocolate. Small chocolate. What is this one? This is going to be a small strawberry. And you could just keep constructing like this, where everything in this row, there's all about small. Whoops. Let me do the. This is small. I'm having trouble changing colors. All right. There is a small, and then this is a small. This is a small vanilla. This color changing is really, it's a difficult thing. Small vanilla. And all of these are all, this would be a medium chocolate, medium strawberry, medium vanilla, large chocolate, large strawberry, large vanilla. And once again, you have 9 outcomes. This is another way to think about all of the possible outcomes when you're looking at these two ways in which my cupcakes could vary. Another way, a third way that you could do it is you could literally just construct a table. Well, you could say, okay, I could have a chocolate. Actually, I'm going to use the letters again. So let's say, let me make, this is the flavor column, and then this is the size column. And so you could say, I could have a chocolate that is, so let's see, there's 3 types of chocolate that I could have there, and they could be small, medium, or large. You could say there is three types of strawberry. It could be small, medium, or large. So let me write that in. Small, medium, large. Or you could say, well, there's 3 types of vanilla. There's 3 types of, color changing again. 3 types of vanilla. Once again, it could be small, medium, or large. So you have these 9 possibilities. Now, the sample space isn't telling you if they're equally likely or not. It's just telling you, if you're going to do an experiment, what are all the different possibilities, the possible outcomes for that experiment? Now, in the case where they are equally likely, it can be very, very useful, because you can say, you could do something like, if you said that, okay, it's equally likely to pick any one of these 9 outcomes, you could say, well, what's the probability of getting something that is either small or chocolate? And so you could see, well, how many of those events out of the total actually meet that constraint? But we'll do more of that in future videos. That's just a little bit of a clue of why we even care about things like sample spaces, especially sample spaces like this, where we're looking along 2 ways or multiple ways that something can vary. And these types of sample spaces in particular are called compound sample spaces. So these right over here, this is a compound sample space, because we're looking at 2 different ways that it can vary, not just to heads or tails. Can vary by size or by flavor. And you can even have compound sample spaces that vary in more than 2 ways.